This is the Bears Barroom Radio Network. Parental discretion is advised.
That is very nice.
Holy smokes!
Chi fans in the stands with Joe Mandel and Greg Braggs. We're here to take a stand for all Chicago's best sports fans. Chi fans in the stands with Joe Mandel and Greg Braggs. We're here to take a stand for all Chicago's best sports fans.
Tammy, it sails to the far side around the 8-yard line to Hester. Under it and to the middle with the 15 to the 20. Breaks free of the 25 to the 30. To the outside. 40. Midfield. 40. 30 to the coast. 20. 15. Hester 5.
Yeah, they look up, you can put it on the board, yeah, yeah.
Bounce toward the middle, Baez,
double play.
Oh my,
oh Mago.
This one turned back around and behind, can be played further, a little twist, he takes score!
Chicago, 17 seconds. 17 seconds from game 7 or from championship number 6. Jordan, open. Chicago with the lead.
You got it, dude.
Oh, yeah.
106 miles to Chicago. We got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses. Hit it.
Hey, shout out to all the Bears Barroom fans, man. It's Jay Woods here.
There we go. I had a hell of a day of practice today.
Keep it up, my man.
First and goal. Rodgers hangs in the pocket, throwing into a lot of traffic, and it's caught for the touchdown by Jimmy Graham.
Should be the final play before the 2-minute warning. Third and 10. Trubisky to the end zone, and it's going to be picked off. It's Adrian Amos who comes back to haunt his old team.
As you get back to work this week, what's the top of your priority list?
Well, figure out how to score more points. 3 points is ridiculous. Just told the guys in there, this is not who we are. I was proud of our defense. I thought they played their ass off tonight. Offensively, not good enough. And we're going to fix it. Our guys know that. We have a locker room of high character people. That's why we bring these guys in, because what they do is they don't point fingers. The defense doesn't point fingers and say the offense should have played better. That's not how we roll. We got to be better. I got to be better. And I think our players understand that. They realize that. I also talked to them and told them that it is the first game of the year. You know, there's a lot more games left. And so I know what kind of guys we have. I'm looking forward to figuring out how we get better, and we're going to do that.
Welcome to Chi Fans in the Stands. I'm your host, Joey Two Scoops. People like to call me by my real name, Joe Mandel. You just heard some terrible highlights from the Bears-Packers game last Thursday night, the season opener. And then you heard Coach Matt Nagy's comments after the game, talking about how the 3 points is unacceptable and how they got to move forward and act like this game and learn from this game. So joining me, as always, guys, is my co-host and the Chi Fan in the Stand, Greggy Sunshine. Greg Braggs Jr. is here with me. Greg, how you feeling, buddy?
What's happening, Joe? Back at it. Yeah, we're licking our wounds still, you know, from that Thursday night debacle, unfortunately. I guess the good news is we have a former Bear to help us get through it.
We do. We have a very special guest, and I'm going to go ahead and dial him up right now. Greg. So without further ado, let's add him to the call and see if he's ready to rock and roll.
A thing or two about the Chicago Bears and Packers rivalry, that's for sure.
Yes, he definitely knows about the Bears-Packers rivalry. We have him joining with us now. Ladies and gentlemen, we have former Bears defensive end and Fox 32 Chicago sports analyst, who also has a new show called Bears Unleashed. Corey Wooten's in the house. Corey, thanks for joining us, my friend.
Oh, yeah, no problem. How you guys doing?
Good. How are you?
Doing great. Looking forward to this week. See if they get with the corrections and hopefully get a dub.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We're feeling a little better now that we're a little further removed from Thursday. That was a tough one, Corey.
Now that you've had a few days,
almost a week to digest this, you know, give us your overall thoughts. You know, there's been so much talk already over the last 5 days. Just give us your overall thoughts of the meltdown that we saw and how you think they'll bounce back.
I think first and foremost, we know the defense is back. The Monsters of the Midway, they are what we thought they were. They picked off right where they left off. I mean, that's a great sign, right, when you have a quarterback that's kind of struggling. But my observation was Trubisky isn't there yet to be able to throw the ball 45 times a game yet, right? He could be there later down the season. But I think you have a three-headed monster in running backs. You got Montgomery, you got Davis, you got Tariq Cohen. Hand the rock off early and often, right? Montgomery, when he was in there, he was gashing him, you know, in the 2-3 carries. He looked good. He's breaking tackles. And you know what that does for an offense, you know, when they see a guy breaking tackles, things of that nature, it picks everybody up. Not only that, you hand the ball off, and then it opens up the play action. So then you get his confidence up. And a guy like Trubisky, he seems a lot more comfortable when he's on the run. So if you're going zone right, zone left, and then all of a sudden you hit a boot, the defense is off balance. You get him on the run, you get his confidence up, and you get these little throws, and then you open up the playbook a little bit. But it starts with running the ball.
It really does start with running the ball. And we saw last night, we saw the Oakland Raiders do that against the Broncos, the team that the Bears are going to play this week. So what do you think for setting up Mitch for success this week? Do you think he can bounce back with a defense like the Broncos?
Yeah, I think he can. I mean, I thought this was a game because the Broncos, traditionally, their first 2 weeks have been lights out at home, you know, at Mile High. I thought their defense, you know, with Vic Fangio there, would just play absolutely on a different level. You know, Von Miller, Bradley Chubb would heat up Derek Carr and just really absolutely get after him. But they really didn't. You know, they didn't have any sacks in the game. And they really had them off balance. You know, they had the running game going. And that's the key component with anybody being successful in this league, is keeping that defense off balance. And that's what the Raiders were able to do. And Derek Carr was 21 of 26. You know,
yes, he was.
Didn't turn the ball over. And that's what you want from your quarterback. Like, that's what we'd like to see from Mitch Trubisky. And we eventually can, but it starts with that running game.
So, you know, you mentioned being, you know, keeping the defense off balance. But unfortunately, what I saw a lot of last Thursday was the offensive line seemed off balance. And I just feel like the new center guard switch between James Daniel and Cody Whitehair is something that's underestimated by fans. You know, there's a lot of communication and responsibility and things of that nature. And I'm just wondering, from your point of view as someone that knows and been in the huddle, how long do you think it's going to take these two to gel and figure this all out to be hitting on all cylinders?
You know, I think it'll take about, you know, 5 to 6 games to really get a feel, like, and fully be comfortable. I think in the next game will be a huge test because they'll be going against that crowd noise. You know, the week before when they played the Packers, they didn't have to deal with that crowd noise and the silent count. So that's something that's going to be key because, you know, Whitehair – or Long, usually it'll probably be Whitehair that does the tap, you know, to let them know when they're going to snap the ball. So it's going to be critical that they're on the same page there because, you know, everybody else is going to be feeding off them, Leno and Massey. They're going to have to be able to get a jump for those big tackles, for those ends, rather, and Miller and Chubb.
You know, to follow up, we saw a lot of stunts. It felt like just watching it back, and it felt like they were trying to confuse these guys. I mean, they obviously have to see this themselves. I mean, are they going to be – able to, I mean, this next week, that's what scares everybody, is this Von Miller and pass rush. Are they going to be able to circumvent that at all with Fangio? I'm just so nervous about the confusion that was up front.
So whenever you have two good pass rushers, and they really have a great front four, front seven, you have to screen and draw them. early and often, right? To get in their head, to kind of take the rushing away. Because teams that could really get up the field, those screens and draws kill them. Because then they're frustrated, you know, they get tired, and then all of a sudden, you know, you bring some three steps and things of that nature. You got to get them off balance, and it starts with that. So I think if they can open up the game plan with some of those screens, maybe to Tariq Cohen, I think that can open up things.
And Corey, on Twitter, you talked a lot this week about the steps that Leonard Floyd and Roy Robertson-Harris took in these games. So talk a little bit more about what you saw from those guys.
Yeah, so Leonard Floyd, I mean, that was a guy that last year I was expecting huge things. And I feel like he finished the season last year very well. You know, he started to produce pass rush-wise, but it still wasn't the level that you thought he'd be at. And in this first game, I mean, just super impressive. And the first sack that he had when Khalil Mack got up the field, he kind of just fell under. That's something that he wouldn't have done last year. I feel like he's understanding how to rush the passer. And that's half the battle when it comes to being a great pass rusher. It's just understanding where to be and how to rush the passer. He knew that Khalil Mack was up at the level. He just folded right under. It was a natural game. It was beautiful. And then the second sack, you know, Bakhtiari is one of the better left tackles in the game. I mean, he's a guy that has great hands, has good jump, good feet. And what he did is you saw his get off up the field. And what he did is he weakened that foot with that speed, and he's able to just punch right through that inside and get Rodgers there. So that's what you love to see. And then Roy Robertson-Harris, he's a guy that I said, pass rush-wise, he's going to break out this year. And you saw why. I mean, he completely put that dude held him. He grown manned him, put him on the ground, and got Rodgers. So, I mean, the length he has, he's a guy that was a former outside linebacker, and he put on weight. He holds it well. And guards cannot contend. He's 6'6", 6'7". You know, it's a long wingspan, and they just cannot grab him when he's able to extend those arms.
Yeah, you mentioned David Bakhtiari has some good hands. He has some good hands, all right. He's always holding everybody.
Yeah, he does hold everybody.
That's my question to you. Is are we ever going to get a call for Khalil Mack? I mean, it seems like this guy is held on every single play. Is this the Shaq rule we're getting with Khalil Mack, the Mack rule?
Yeah, it seems like it. I mean, but you look around the league, and I watch games, and I'm like, oh, my, he held him so bad. And it's like most of the time they do not call it. I don't know, for whatever reason. Because literally they can call holding every play. You know, the defense has an advantage. So I think they try to limit it unless it really impacts the play most of the time. And it's a shame because you're sometimes like, oh, I had a great rush. I may not have got a sack, but he still held me. But I think that's what it's coming to. Like, if it's not going to affect the play, and it wasn't like a blatant, like, oh, I threw him to the ground and clotheslined him, they don't call it.
We're doing our best on Twitter to hit up the NFL officials to let them know.
Hashtag can't hold Mac. There you go.
They don't want to listen.
No, they don't. And we saw that offensive line for the Denver Broncos look really questionable last night. What are your expectations for this Bears defense going into next week?
Hey, heat them up, you know. My thing is, you knock out that running game. You know, Philip Lindsay is really talented. But the Raiders were able to control him, and I think that's the biggest thing. If you can knock out that running game and put the pressure on Flacco, because I don't think he's an elite quarterback that can really carry a team with his arm. So if you put that pressure on him and you're able to heat him up in those situations, then that's the great part about this Bears defense, is you can run a lot of stunts. You can run a lot of games. You got different looks where you can put Khalil Mack inside rushing as a tackle. You know, you got Roy Robertson-Harris that's in there. You know, you have so many options. You know, Aaron Lynch, and that's the great part about it. Oh, these guys are taking the next step that you want to see. So you have, you know, 6 or 7 different rushers that you can bring in at any point in time. And in this league, you can never have enough rushers. So I think they're going to be able to heat them up, but it starts with stopping that running game.
How much of a concern is this altitude? You know, it's all the talk going into this week between Fangio and the altitude. How much of a concern is the altitude, and what should we expect? Is it at the end of a long drive, or is it the fourth quarter? Like, you know, what is the deal with this?
Yeah, I mean, I played there back in 2011 when the whole Tebow phenomenon was there, when he was playing there, and he came back on us. But it definitely do get winded a little bit easier. But what I'm hoping is they get a great rotation early on, so they keep those guys fresh, especially the starters for that fourth quarter. And it seems like, you know, throughout the game last week, I mean, they were interchanging guys, Aaron Lynch here and there, Roy Robertson-Harris. They were interchanging all these guys. So that's the key, is having a great rotation. So then in the fourth quarter, everybody's fresh and they're able to have all hands on deck. And if there's a two-minute situation, everybody's ready to go.
Yeah, so you mentioned, you know, the heartbreaking loss in Denver, you know, that you guys had a Tebow. I never forget that. I literally had to go outside. I was so upset with the way with Barber went out of bounds. Like, I can still remember play by play. It was like 15 miracles that got them to win that game, and sure enough, he did. That was a wild run for Tebow. So you know all about, you know, expectations in this city and having to overcome adversity. And so now I guess I just try to wrap this up with you is your prediction for week two. Do you think this team is going to be able to bounce back? Are they going to be able to respond to all the criticism that we're hearing so far, especially with Matt Nagy and Mitchell Trubisky? What's your prediction for the game if you had one?
Yeah, so right after the game, my initial gut reaction was they're going to lose this next game just because Mile High is a tough place to play. But I should have reconsidered after I saw Denver playing and saw what they put out there. And I feel a lot better about this now. I feel like Flacco is who we thought he was. You know, I don't think he's ready to completely carry a team yet. And I think they're going to bounce back. I think Matt Nagy is going to run the ball a lot more. I feel like he got a little too cute, and he realized that he took accountability for it. And I think it's going to come down to a ground-and-pound type of game early on, you know, some play actions. They'll get Trey Burton back, and that's a security blanket for Trubisky. That's going to be somebody he's going to connect to early and often. But I think it starts with that screen game, the draw game, getting the run game going, and defensively, like I said, stopping that run. But offensively, I think that's where we're going to see the biggest difference this week, because if they're going to be a great team like we know they can be, and all the expectations and the hype and to live up that, they have to change the game plan. It starts with running that football.
Yep.
Yes, sir. And we've got two more for you before we let you go. We got one question in the chat room for you, Corey. Aldo in the chat room wants to know, would love to know if Corey in his prime could have played a 3-4 outside linebacker. I always thought he could. Was I off base?
So I feel like I could have played definitely a 3-4, like, 2012, that's when I was probably about 270. I think I could have played a stand-up outside linebacker then. And then towards the end of my career, I feel like I probably could have played a 5 technique, probably very good. You know, it was more about 290 then, and feel like that would have fit. But outside linebacker, I mean, that would have been so dope, standing up, rushing faster, dropping the coverage a little bit, you know, every now and again. So I had pretty good hands, so.
There you go, man. That would have been a lot of fun. And last but not least, before we let you go, Corey, we got to tell us a little bit about your new show, Bears Unleashed.
Yeah, so Bears Unleashed is a show we do every Friday night. It's at 9:30, and it's myself, Shea Pepler, Brittany Payton, and Gabe Ramirez. And we talk about all things Bears and then, you know, the hot topics around the league. You know, we got into Antonio Brown last week, Andrew Luck. We get into fashion stuff. I mean, we get everything, you know, so – It's a great show, a lot of fun. You know, we have a lot of fun with each other, and you guys check it out. So it's on Fox 32, 9:30 p.m. every Friday.
Yeah, again, Corey, really appreciate your time. I know it's late. I know you're busy this time of year, getting things warmed up on the season. And, look forward to seeing you again here at Soldier Field. Hopefully the next time I see you there, the Bears are in a better spot because, you know, that was a little disappointing here coming out the gate.
Exactly. They'll bounce back. You know, Matt Nagy, you know, I think he's a great coach. He's got the camaraderie there. He's got the chemistry. And I think if he just get that game plan right, and, you know, the lack of preseason definitely hurt them a little bit, but it's how they respond now. So this game is really critical to see how they're gonna impact their game planning for the weeks to follow. So,
you know, one more before I go, you know, everybody always refers to you as the guy that ended Brett Favre's career. Do you like being known as – I know that's like – kind of a cool, iconic moment, but sounds so harsh to say something like that. And I didn't know if we should even say that as an introduction to you. But do you like hearing that all the time about how you ended his career, so to speak?
Yeah, I mean, I just don't like that because it almost puts a negative connotation. Like, Chicago fans, they love it. They're like, oh, we hated Favre. Like, oh, you killed him, whatever. And I'm like, oh. No, the thing is, you never, you know, as a football player, obviously, you know, you try to go out there and you try to hit people and whatever, but you never want anyone to get hurt. That's the only issue I have with it. I think it's funny when people say it, you know, oh, the Favre killer or whatever, but it's just like a negative, because I didn't go out purposely to hurt him, but, you know, it's football, you know,
sure,
I was trying to make a play, and it happened. But that's what everybody says.
He was old anyway. He was getting ready to retire.
Exactly. Yeah, Bears fans were excited about that because Brett Favre torched you guys for years.
Yeah. So a quick station ID before you go.
What's that?
Quick station ID before you go.
Station ID.
Yeah, you just like little – this is Corey Wootton listening to Shy Fans in the Stands.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, we ain't got nothing for our intro. We need something for our intro, my man. Yeah. You're a former Chicago Bear, so ain't nobody better.
Okay.
All right. So listen to Corey Wootton. Corey Wootton. You're listening to Shy Fans in the Stands.
This is Corey Wootton. You're listening to Shy Fans in the Stands.
Boom.
We get it, Joe? Was it clean?
Let's do one more. I'll count you in just in case it got cut off, and then we'll do it. We go 3, 2, 1.
What's up, everybody? This is Corey Wootton, and you're listening to Shy Fans in the Stands.
Boom. There it is. Boom. All right, with a stamp on it.
Thanks for putting up with us, man. We'll see you at Soldier Field soon enough.
Sounds good. You guys have a good one.
Thanks for joining us. Appreciate it, Corey.
No problem. Get easy, man.
Guys, that was Corey Wootton, absolute boss, bringing it every single time. Corey, thank you so much for joining us. And Greg, we got a great station ID for the beginning of our show now.
Of course, I had to cut off the first take. I have Aldo's listening. He knew that I would cut him off during his first take.
Oh, Aldo knew. He put in the chat room, Aldo's got the 3-2-1 in there. So I'm like, let me do the 3-2.
Oh, man. Yeah, I was when I was thinking about the intro, it was going to be like, do we add in the man that ended Brett Favre's career? Because you hear that so much from the fans. But I was like, you know, these guys are in a fraternity. You know, they are a part of the same fraternity, whether it's Bears, Packers, anybody. And at the end of the day, they all walk off that field, you know, husbands and fathers and things like that. And, you know, to say someone ended another guy's career and kind of gloat about it seems a little tough. So I always wondered how he felt about that. You know, it's an iconic tackle, obviously, but, you know, I mean, tough for anybody to end their career, you know. But like we said, you know, Brett was getting a little long in the tooth at that time, so we won't shed too many tears for the man that ripped our heart out.
Well, I tell you what, he was pretty funny on that Superfans thing before the game on Thursday. I don't know if you saw it.
No, I did. It was real. They did a good job of both those in the Peyton Manning one.
The Peyton Manning one was the best.
Yeah, without question. The beef juice.
baptized in the beef juice. The Bears.
Oh, man. Yeah, I'm glad we could laugh about something because that was such a tough game, Joe, Thursday night. It was totally euphoric feeling. Pre-game, I went up bright and early. Was taking video of the statue while no one was really around it. And then you get to the NFL 100 Village, and it was such an awesome event. It was like going to like Nashville or something that was just a really big setup with all these different stages and all these things going on. Madden, a huge Madden tent where these guys are playing Madden against other players. Devin Hester played Madden against regular fans for like an hour and a bunch of them. Like, I thought he'd only be there for, like, 10 minutes. He was there for, like, an hour. Brian Urlacher's popping into the Verizon store. You got Matt Forte and Jim McMahon and Richard Dent walking around. Literally, not because it was so spread out, there wasn't that many people around, like, each area. So it wasn't like a bombardment, except around the NFL Network studio tent where they actually were doing their live showings throughout the day. You had Kay Adams and Kyle Brandt, James Jones, and everything. Oh, it was awesome. It was like a celebrity who's who for football celebrities and Chicago Bears celebrities. It was awesome. And then to have what happened in that game, it was just, it totally let the air out. The defense comes out with their hair on fire. You think they're going to win by 50, and they just can't muster one measly touchdown on the board. And before you know it, it's the fourth quarter, and you're down, and you're scratching and clawing for a game. I was worried about the game, but I would have never been able to tell you that we were going to struggle that bad offensively.
Yeah, I didn't see it coming, Greg, and it was one of those things that just kind of caught me by surprise, then caught everybody by surprise by the lack of game plan. At least to me, it seemed like it was a lack of game plan. Matt Nagy looked like he you know, peed down his leg because some of the play calling was absolutely horrendous in that game.
Yeah, you know, it just, it was a combination, you know, but for sure to go to Nagy first, the run pass disparity is unacceptable. I think it was 31 or 37. It was probably 31 consecutive pass attempts in the second half. And I don't want to hear about RPOs. That's fine that maybe he called RPOs, that he preferred runs and Mitch wasn't identifying and calling the pass. Then call a just a regular run play, not an RPO. Just call HB dive. You know, I mean, come on, guys. Like, run it once, you know. And like Phil alluded to on the Tape Never Lies, another outstanding edition this week by Phil Toshin. Yeah, go check it out on YouTube. And a 20-minute breakdown of all of Mitch's throws, the good and the bad. As he pointed out, you know, it just, why are you going to Cordarrelle Patterson on the run? I mean, like, just go to your horses when you need to. You know, I just really frustrating to see from Matt Nagy, especially in a game that was winnable. It's one thing if you have a 45-11 pass disparity when you're down 3 score. But it was a 4-point game most of the game. To not run it 31 times in a row is inexcusable. David Montgomery, 1 carry in the second half. Tariq Cohen, 0 carries for the game. You know, and like people say, it's a trend we've seen with Matt Nagy, and I hope he wakes up to it, you know. And it's just, it's frustrating, really frustrating. You want to see more of David Montgomery next week, and maybe there was some checks at the line of scrimmage or understanding route concepts off audibles and things of that nature that a lot of us fans aren't privy to that kind of knowledge. But I still just need to see more. I need to see more David Montgomery. But we're going to find out. You know, we're going to find out what this team's all about. They're getting a lot of heat. Matt's getting a lot of heat. Mitchell's getting a lot of heat. But it's nothing they can't overcome, Joe.
I agree. And you saw the recipe for success last night. You saw the Raiders and how they used Josh Jacobs against that Broncos defense. I think the Bears, if they're smart, they're going to follow and do the exact same thing with Montgomery. And, I mean, you got to give the kid the ball more. You got to run the ball, and you got to let the run open it up for Mitch, because they knew it was coming all game long. And if you know the pass is coming, they're bringing the house. And that O-line just has to be better this week as well.
Yeah, they just look completely confused. Like we were saying, even on the court, like the on the Tape Never Lies, where Phil points out the Cordarrelle run, James Daniels, it just completely get whiffs on his block, and Bradley Sowell completely whiffs on his block. And, it all completely ties in. You know, for people to completely put it on Mitch, I think, is a bit much. Not to say that he isn't, you know, absolved from criticism, but when you're not running the ball 11 times calling the run play, when you're not blocking, when you are running good plays and you're getting penalties, and, you know, for the most part, receivers weren't getting open. I'm not seeing the separation you need to see, you know, in order to really, you know, say, hey, Mitch, you got to hit that guy. But most guys weren't open. So it's hard to decipher at this point.
It is hard to decipher. You know, this team is kind of, I don't want to say in shambles, but they're definitely against the ropes after that performance. And they're going to have a lot to prove this week coming out. So, you know, Matt Nagy is going to be getting after those guys. And if they don't come up fired up, there's definitely something wrong.
Right. You know, I mean, and they've shown that they can bounce back. Last year, within the season, they bounced back off the 0-1 loss. Then they bounced back from the 3-3 start. Then they bounced back at the end of the year when they started to struggle. At the end of the Rams game, whatever you want to say, they started to struggle. Then they bounced back at the end of the year. Then in the playoffs, they had an ugly first half. They bounced back in the second half. So, in my opinion, we've seen that bounce back capability. I know we didn't see it in week one. Credit Mike Pettine of Green Bay. He had a good game plan. I think that's just something people need to come to grips with. Sometimes the other team gets paid too, and sometimes they do a good job of what they're trying to do. That's what happens in a loss. The other team outplayed you, outsmarted you, you know, whatever you want to say. You know, obviously we want to see more touchdowns on the board, but, you know, Mike Pettine had their number for one night. But I've seen the bounce back ability. This team, obviously Denver looks like a tough place to play, but the Bears are the better team. So I need to see a win coming out of there. You know, it'd be great if Mitch could sling it so we could have the polar opposite happen. So we
bury the hatchet.
Yeah, so we get everybody to chill out on Mitch. You know, this whole we're going to make it an indictment on his career after every game thing and just continue to pin him on Patrick Mahomes and Deshaun Watson when he wasn't the one. He didn't draft himself at 2. That was Ryan Pace that did that. And he's doing the best he can. Is he better than those guys? Maybe not. But at the same time, if you're a Bears fan, you got to ride with this dude. That's who we picked. And he can't change that. We can't change that. Pace can't change that. So we're just going to keep drilling this dude because he isn't at the Mahomes or Watson level. Maybe all three of these guys end up being good. You know, can we just give the kid a chance is what I'm saying. I mean, especially, you know, in my opinion, someone, a kid that has built himself up some equity from last year, having the season he had. And it's amazing how many excuses against the season he had, I hear. You know, it's like I got to, like, defend him and say all the – it acts like I'm like a homer by trying to point out the positives that we had from him last year. Obviously, the players and the coaches in the league saw it because they voted him into the Pro Bowl. So it's frustrating to see a little bit of the piranhas jump out at Mitchell Trubisky. He's a young quarterback, and we finally found somebody that's halfway competent, and people are treating him like, you know, he's David Carr. You know, it's like, come on, guys.
Right.
Can we relax a little bit? Matt Stafford has been wildly average for 11 years with the Detroit Lions, and I don't think he has received this much criticism from his fan base. Cam Newton, I'm watching him the other day, wildly inconsistent, and he dang near won a Super Bowl for the Panthers. You know,
Greg, I'm going to stop you for a second because that's what you get, right, when you get expectations that are so sky high. And when right. You come out and you drop a stinker, like not just Mitch did, but the whole team did, except for Allen Robinson, when you drop a stinker like that, you're setting yourself up for criticism. And I'm not saying that it's warranted. I'm just saying when you have such high expectations and you perform like they did on Thursday, then that's kind of what happens.
100%. It was a storm between the pomp and circumstance of the game, the 8 months leading up since the double doink
and the stage.
Disappointment, and the stage, and Bears-Packers and everything. But, you know, it's just like, okay, so you fans didn't expect anything last year and got gold. And now this year they're expecting something, and they get let down to start, and we're already heaping and harping and booing and hissing. And it's like, hey, what? Get behind your team for a second. I mean, man, half of them feel like they're jumping ship before there's even a little water in the boat. I'm scared to imagine what happens if this team fails to make the playoffs. I want them to make the playoffs as much as anyone, if not more. And, you know, guess what? Only 6 teams are going to make it. Someone's going to fail to make the playoffs. That's trying really hard. And that team might be us, and I don't want it to be, but, you know, there has to be some perspective. There has to be context within how these things happen. And if James Daniels and Cody Whitehair never get it figured out all year, you can't just completely harp everything. They're all connected is what I'm trying to say. And I just want to take it game by game, and let's see how it goes. Hopefully the Bears can start stacking wins, because what happened last year is they had a winning ball club while they were developing a quarterback, so nobody complains that much as long as you're winning games. As soon as you start losing games, that's when that patience with the quarterback runs out. I get it. We have a Super Bowl window here. We have a great defense. But that doesn't change whatever Mitch's story and whatever his line of progression is going to be. Whatever it is whatever it is. That has nothing to do with where the defense is currently. So, you know, if Mitch's line of success takes a little longer, are we going to run him out of town before we get to reap those rewards because he didn't fit the window of opportunity? You know, I want to develop Mitch, and I want the city to get behind this kid the way he's gotten behind this city. He came here when this team was nothing, and no one cared about us, and he helped lead this team to where they are now. He's a huge part of that. And for people to try to drag him through the Colts, Bears fan, I expect it from everybody else. But from Bears fans, it's a little disappointing. Come on. This is our guy. How many years did we stick up for Jay Cutler? He didn't deserve 1 ounce of what Mitchell Trubisky deserves as far as appreciation or rooting for him, our rooting interest. You know, we all want him to do great, but, you know, we all do. We all fan a little different, but, you know, I want everyone to just send the positive vibes. It helps. If everyone's got a negative vibe walking into the stadium, you know, I just feel like that kind of carries over. And it might sound crazy, but that's just my belief. And last year, the positive vibes were everywhere, the sidelines, the stadium, everywhere. And it wasn't when they were just winning. When they were 3-3 early on, there was vibes that were good. Everybody wasn't out there booing and hissing at 3-3. They were, you know, supportive of the team because they were a team on the come up. So, like you said, expectations are here, but you know, come on, we're still early in this. Let's see what we got. You know what I'm saying, Joe?
Yes, sir. I'm with you. The expectations are there, and you got to get behind your guy. And we're going to keep talking about football, Greg, but we have some breaking news that I'm going to break right now.
We interrupt this program for breaking Bears Barroom news.
Guys, we have some breaking news coming out of Milwaukee. Brewers outfielder Christian Yelich has a fractured kneecap and he is out for the rest of the season.
Wow.
This is huge news for the Cubs as they are in a heated race against the Brewers in that division. So Yelich is out for the rest of the year. What a terrible break after fouling a ball off of his kneecap today. Yelich out for the year. What breaking news. That's coming from The Athletic, from Andre Fernandez. So
unbelievable, man. The hits keep coming for the NL Central, and the Cardinals seem to be dodging these bullets so far. But, yeah, last week we had the news of Javi Baez missing the rest of the regular season with a hairline fracture in his thumb, and now here it is, Christian Yelich out for the season. That's shocking. And the Brewers were starting to really climb in the wild card race. I believe they're only two back of the Cubs of the second spot. And,
yep.
You know, now they're, you know, both the Cubs and the Brewers seem to have decent schedules down the stretch. But both teams without their leaders now going down the stretch. So it's going to be interesting to see how it wraps up. I mean, for both teams, it's been somewhat of a disappointing season already. And then to have your leader be out for the year, deemed out for the year, is just a gut punch that most teams can't overcome. But there's two wild card spots, and you know the rest of the NL still kind of trying to climb up to the Cubs' second spot. So maybe the Cubs slide in there with this news. You know, it's hard to say. It's just been such an up and down year. And last night they got a little spark from their rookie shortstop they called up from Double-A Tennessee, Nico Horner, 3-for-4, 4 RBIs, I believe, or 4 RBIs, yeah, and he's the first Cubs rookie to do that since 1952. So, you know, that was a good sign, but, you know, they've had what goes up must come down. So the next one thing goes right, three things go wrong. So
it's
interesting, but with the Brewers, you know, that's going to make life real hard for them. He's their most clutch hitter, no question about it.
Yeah, man, it's a big night for breaking news. Of course, during Fantasy Football Goon tonight, we got wind of Antonio Brown being accused of sexual assault. His lawyer released a statement. I mean, it's just been an absolutely wild night for news, and we're bringing it all to you on the Bears Ballroom Radio Network.
That's right. Tomorrow night, we got 100 Proof Live, correct, Joe?
Yes, we have a live episode of 100 Bears 100 Proof. You're going to have the barkeeper, Aldo Gandia, draft Dr. Phil, and the smartest man in the barroom, Shane Marsaw. Make sure you hop in the chat room, join the conversation. And, of course, I'm sure they'll be talking a little bit about Phil's breakdown of The Tape Never Lies. Head over to YouTube and check it out. Phil breaks down all of Mitch Trubisky's snaps. And let me just paint you a little picture. It's not as bleak as it looks, Greg.
No, it was nice these last few days. you know, we get the Brett Coleman's and other video analysts of, you know, the web that give the negative breakdown. And you need that as a fan to stay balanced. But it was nice to see Draft Dr. Phil and even Tom Waddle on his show with Waddle and Sylvie. They both came away from the film, the All-22 Coaches film, as they call it, not as displeased with Mitch's play on Thursday. And that's good to hear. You know, for me, being in the stands, my point of view, it's hard to take it all in as far as line play and receivers and quarterback play because, you know, I'm kind of lower down on, like, in an end zone, so you only get a certain angle. So it was hard to really digest it all. I had to go back and watch it. But I didn't get a chance to watch the All-22. So it's good to hear from guys that have a trained football eye come away with it and say, hey, you know, Mitchell battled. He didn't play that bad. He had his mistakes, but, you know, overall there were good signs. And that's all you want, you know. Like Phil pointed out in the Tape Never Lies session this episode, it's a game of inches, and the narrative changes if Taylor Gabriel gets his feet in, if Taylor Gabriel catches that ball, you know, that's dropped dime ball over the linebacker's hands. You know, there's just so many different instances. And that's why I continue to harp on the fact that it was a connected effort all across the board. And that's why you need guys like Phil to be able to break it down for an average fan like me or you, Joe, that, you know, doesn't see the nuance that creates the domino effect of a play, and that's why certain things happen. Yeah, Allen Robinson streaking across the middle open. But Mitch is eluding from the pocket because they can't block a freaking safety coming in around the edge. I mean, come on, guys. You know, it's – and that's the whole thing about preseason, you know. Yeah. And I pointed it out on Twitter. Most people were arguing back with me at the time, but I just felt like the only sliver of hope the Packers had was that we were rusty, and there it was. The most frustrating part about it is we were rusty, but we should have been able – and this is where I'll agree with the Mitch detractors. Regardless of the rust and regardless of all the problems, you got it. You should still be able to get a touchdown. One, you know, like just with a few good – string a few good plays together. And that's the biggest frustration was that four quarters, they couldn't find one opportunity – to get one in there. That's frustrating.
Mitch has got to get the ball out of his hands quickly. I mean, he really does. And then my number one comment on top of that is Kyle Long just has to play better this week. He did not play a good game at all. I mean, the whole line didn't, but I think Kyle Long needs to really step up big time.
100%. You know, it's so, you know, they sit there and try to put it all on Mitch, and I'll just continue to harp on this. It's not. So we don't have to continue to beat that drum, but it'll be nice to see if they can respond this week so we can get, you know, a little more balance to the conversation, because right now all the Mitch detractors are just feasting. It's tough.
Oh, yeah.
It's tough out there in them Twitter streets, Joe, defending my boy Money Mitch. Nobody wants to listen anymore.
Yeah, people have it out for Mitch all of a sudden. That's all I heard. I was wearing my Bears outfit on Sunday, walking around, and people are like, oh, dude, take that off. I'm like, no, I'm not taking it off. It's one game, man. Relax. Don't overreact to it. I mean, so many people just want to hate on the Bears right now, and just give them time. It's a long season. You know, they didn't play a lot in the preseason. So, you know, now we give them the chance to come out and prove themselves against the Broncos on Sunday.
Yeah, and you got to feel good after what you saw last night with Denver.
Yeah.
For the Bears' opportunity. But, you know, it's never – sometimes it's tough when a team loses. Just like the Bears, they're going to be geared up to try to win. Home opener, you know, and all that stuff. But the Bears have had extra days to prepare, so – I feel good about it. I just need to see it, you know. Once they get the ball rolling, I think the wins will be easier to predict. But right now, while they're still in this, like, where are they mode as a team, are they engaged yet, it's really hard to say how they're going to come out week to week. Last year, you knew. And I mean, I guess after the first week, but even the first week they came out firing, and then they ultimately blew that game just the same. But, you know, you weren't worried week to week how they were going to come out. So this is a little bit new of a thing. And just like you said, with expectations and the way they affect fans, expectations affect the players too. And last year they were able to play a lot more loose and free because they weren't as stressed about what they were going to be at the end of the year. They were just having fun growing. And they fell short, and the double doink ripped their heart out. And you could tell that all offseason at Bears 100 or at training camp, you could still feel that they felt like they missed an opportunity. And maybe that's what kind of butted its head all the way into that first week, is that was still on their mind. And maybe a slap in the mouth by Green Bay is what they needed to wake themselves up to realize that game is over. And we got to stop thinking about the Philadelphia, you know, double doink. And now we have a new debacle, the week one Green Bay debacle to stress about. And hopefully that's what wakes them up. You know, it's a long season, and everyone wants instant gratification. I want it as much as anyone. I wanted 5-0 start. So now I want 4-1. You know, this is the vital point in their season, Joe. They got to get some wins before the bye week, because after the bye, after week six bye, they play the Saints, the Eagles, and the Chargers 3 in a row. I'm not sure if I got my order confused on that, but they have Eagles, Saints, Chargers as their first three, or Saints, Eagles, Chargers as their first three coming out the bye. So they have to string some wins together here, or this season could get away from them. And that's my biggest fear as a Bears fan right now.
Yeah, so here's the schedule, Greg. So they play the Broncos, obviously, next week. Then they got the Redskins, Vikings, Raiders, Saints, Chargers, Eagles. So, yeah, that's a pretty tough stretch right there. I just got to get through it all. Obviously, I'm going to be at that Saints game, courtesy of my fabulous fiance, and probably the best game experience I'll have in my entire life. So I'm very excited.
Hopefully they built a crap load of momentum by then. If they can find a way to win in Denver, they've got the Redskins on Monday Night Football at Washington. You know, Darius Geis is out right now.
They
took an early lead on Philly and completely blew that game.
Fell apart.
And so you got to feel decent about that matchup if they can get through Denver 1 week at a time, so to speak. But my mind doesn't work that way as a fan. So if they can build that momentum and win those two, then you come back home against the Vikings. It's a short week, yes, but it's your home field. It's the first time you come back from what happened against Green Bay here. And hopefully they have a two-win streak momentum. And then that will be a huge statement game early on in the season to get to 3-1 before you head to London to play the Raiders, who we don't really know what they are right now. They beat the Broncos, sure. But, you know, we're going to find out if they're going to continue to ride this, hey, we'll show Antonio Brown wave. They surprised some people, I think, last night by beating Denver the way they did. But we'll see where they're at in 5 weeks. You know, it's, you know, I think fans will underestimate them without Antonio Brown, and that might be a mistake. But the Bears are still a better team than them. And if they can get through that stretch and get to the bye week by the grace of God at 4-1, and I know that's asking a lot as a fan, but, hey, this is what you need to get to the playoffs, people. So they need to go on a run. And if they can, they get 2 weeks to prepare for one of the biggest home games of the year. And you're going, Bears-Saints. Not only are you going, you're 50-yard line, row one, seat one, Joe. Behind the Bears bench. So that could be one of the defining moments of the season. And then you're playing the New Orleans Saints, who are the favorites in the NFC right now, especially after what you saw last night against the Texans. You know, they don't blink. Deshaun Watson leads them down to a go-ahead touchdown with 30 seconds left. And what do you know? Drew Brees, future Hall of Famer, gets them right down into field goal range to win the game.
58-yarder to win the game right down the pipe. That would have been good probably from 64, 65, Greg.
And his career-long had been 57 prior to that. So he had a lot of juice behind that ball, and they've got a lot chip on their shoulder as well from how they finished last year, you know, with the refs taken their, you know, chance at a Super Bowl away. So it's going to be an interesting season. There's a lot of season left, but that doesn't mean the Bears have time to wake up. They don't have time. They have to wake up right now, because if you build yourself too big of a hole before you get into that tougher part, and it's going to be a tall order. So, you know, I'm excited still as a fan. Definitely disappointed after the first week, but nothing that I'm running and hiding under my pillow for yet. Now, they score 3 points again this week. I am going to be really, really concerned about everything and probably crying in the fetal position for a week. So I'd appreciate it if my guys could come through and score a few touchdowns and make me feel better about everything going on.
Oh, I sure hope so, man. Anything's better than last week, let's be honest.
Yeah, there's no question about that. That's how it goes, though, you know. It's Bears, Packers, they get paid too. You know, we played them coming. Mitch diced them up to clinch the division last year. You know, Mike Pettine's been, this is his second year now, you know, installing that defense into the Packers. And, you know, they threw us a curveball. We got a new center and a new guard switching positions. We had a new running back, rookie running back, and a new veteran running back brought in free agency. All these guys are learning this system. You got to understand checks, the line of scrimmage, and audibles and everything else. And now you got the Packers throwing these crazy blitzes. Different guys are coming at you, different stunts, and no one seemed to be able to pick anyone up. So, you know, they credit to them. They had a good game plan. They had us confused, and that led to Mitch and Nagy looking bad, and Nagy not calling the run has no excuse. Nagy not kicking that ball on 4th and 10 when we hadn't had a 12-yard completion all night. It's his fault. I'm sorry. Kick that ball. What are we doing here, people? You know? But I'm, you know, I digress. It's got a long ways to go. We got a long ways to go, Joe.
Yeah, it's a long ways to go, no doubt about it. And, man, Greg, football week one was so full of ups and downs. So much awesome football. Obviously, we didn't watch one of those games last Thursday, but the rest of them were pretty darn good. But I'm just excited for football season, and I don't know about you, Greg, but I think you're pretty excited for the Bears game coming up this week.
Yeah, no question. 3:25 start. It's a road game, so we won't be in attendance, unfortunately, unless I fly out to Denver impromptu, which I won't. You never know, though. And we got the Vikings and Packers at noon. Then we got the Bears and Vikings at 3:25. So Sunday's going to be sit on your couch and get ready and hold on tight, because this is the week to respond. There's no time to wait, no time to waste. If you're Mitchell Trubisky and Matt Nagy, you gotta slap these detractors back. You know, they've been beating them down into the dirt for the last week, and it's not going to stop until they win. And then if they win, everyone will go away for a little bit until he screws up in some big game, and then they'll all come back.
Yeah.
And that's just how it goes.
Well, I think a lot of people are probably going to be rooting for the Vikings this week, even though they're both 1-0. Anything to watch the Packers lose, right, Greg?
I guess I'm indifferent. You know, at this point, I would say the Vikings are the better team between the two of them. So I guess in that sense, maybe the Vikings losing a game wouldn't hurt. But the Packers have 5 of their next 6 games at home. So might be good to have them lose a game here, too, because they might be able to stack some together with that kind of a home stretch. Their end of their schedule's got to be tough if their next 5 or 6 are at home, but might need, you know, like I said, 6-1, half a dozen in the other when it comes to who's going to lose that game. But how funny was the Detroit meltdown, you know, up 3 in the 4th quarter and to fall apart and let Arizona come back and tie that game and end the game in a tie. I mean, come on now, Detroit.
Yeah, it was pretty horrendous, and it's kind of sad that we're the only team without a win, Greg.
It is very sad. It is very, very sad. Well, but I guess it's where they were to start last year.
I guess we're not the only team without a win. We're the only team with a loss in our division.
That's right. And I believe I read somebody said we were in last place in week 8 of last year. We started 3-3, and then I think there was a bye. So I think we started week 8 in last place last season. So it's that just goes to show you how long the season is. I'm not worried. You know, I just want to get back to Soldier Field with good vibes. I don't want to be in that tailgate lot with everyone hating on Mitch. The first game was so much fun, and that's why I was nervous. You go around in the lot, and everyone's like, Bears are going to win by 50, and it's like listening to a bunch of Gregs in the lot. And when it gets like... When it gets like that, that's when I get scared. When everyone starts agreeing on something, that's when I tend to go the other way because, you know, in sports, it's what comes up must come down. And when everyone thinks one thing, it normally goes the other way, or at least it feels like that. And everyone thought the Bears were going to blow them out of the water. And I just kept saying, you know, that's just not how it goes. That's not how football works. This game's going to be decided by a field goal is how I felt. You know, I'm not going to be one too many times to predict us to lose when we're a good team, but I definitely was nervous about the game overall. Never would have been able to expect the offensive output they had, but it's almost funny, Joe. I was thinking on Sunday, too, watching the Lions blow it, how funny or just how weird it is with football. Like the Bears, we have been spending 50 years with the same problem that we can never get the quarterback right. It's always defense, and no offense. A Hall of Fame defense and a putrid offense. And no matter what we do, no matter how many players we trade, new names we put on the jerseys, new coaches, offensive philosophy, it doesn't matter. We always revert back to who we are. And it's like the Lions, the same thing. It's like they always seem to be the team that if they're up big, they give up the lead. Or if they're down big, they'll come back. And you saw that. And it's almost kind of funny how football works sometimes. It's, you know, it's you live your fate, your destiny.
We live our fate and our destiny every week, Greg. And we get to do a fun show about Chicago sports and about being a fan in the stands, Greg. And I'd be doing a disservice to the show if I didn't talk about a monster concert for next year that was announced today. Announced coming to Wrigley Field next August, the Super Mega Tour, August 13th, 2020. You've got Green Day, Fall Out Boy, and Weezer all in the same show. Talk about a monster event, Greg. That's going to be a hot ticket.
And that's at Wrigley Field, huh?
Yeah, Wrigley Field, August 13th, 2020.
Man, what an awesome venue for that kind of a show, too. I went to Tom Petty there a couple years ago. Actually, it was a few months before Tom Petty passed away, and it was an amazing show. And so, yeah, that one with that whole slate of bands, you know, that takes me back to my high school days for sure.
Yeah, and now Green Day, Rock and Roll Hall of Famers, Fall Out Boy and Weezer, nothing to slouch at either, just some quality tunes across the board.
Love Weezer. We love Weezer. They're the best, man. That was what it was all about. But yeah, it's an interesting time. We've got like 20 games left in the baseball season, winding down here for the playoff run. See if the Cubs can continue their playoff streak. We've got Bears Broncos here in a few days. The guys on Bears 100 Proof, Shane and Phil and Aldo, will be getting you ready for that. You know, and you know, the Blitz football guys are going to be putting their thing out tomorrow. And, you know, it's exciting. It's an exciting time, you know, to get back to Sunday. That's all we wait for now each week is to get back to Sunday to see the new results. But, yeah, I'm excited to hopefully next Tuesday come back with a nice little breakdown from what we saw in Denver. And hopefully we're talking about much better circumstances.
Oh, I hope so, man. And I think they're going to play a lot better. The Broncos looked a little lost out there last night. Joe Flacco does not look like the answer. And I'm looking forward to seeing Khalil sack Joe Flacco three times on Sunday.
Yeah, and I'm not sure if Drew Lock is available for the yet. Is he? I want to say he got IR'd.
Yeah, I believe he's IR'd.
So even if Joe was struggling really hard, we wouldn't see him. You know, I don't know if they'd go to that early since they paid Flacco, but no, they got to get back to running the ball no matter what. You also got to feel better about, like, what's crazy is the defense can actually play better than how they played. As amazing as they played, there's going to be games where they get waterfalls for turnovers. They couldn't quite hit that. I thought maybe the other night I was, like, praying to the Eddie Jackson gods. I'm like, please, Eddie, save us, because last year
that was the
type of game that he would save us in and then get those good vibes rolling. But they just couldn't quite. You know, Aaron Rodgers is just so good at not turning that ball over. But fortunately, Joe Flacco isn't as disciplined, and let's hope he's not. You know, everyone's so afraid to jinx anything for this week. So hopefully he's doing his regular Joe Flacco stuff. I'll just leave it at that. But, yeah, we just need a win, and hopefully the guys on Bears 100 Proof can talk us off the ledge tomorrow. Looking forward to listening to that. It's cool they're now live. You know, they used to do it just on the podcast version, but it's cool to hear it live. You never know what's going to happen on the airwaves that way.
Yeah, or what's going to get cut from the show. You never know. Sometimes you get some crazy people that show up on the show, and, you know.
And you can only hear if you're listening live, and if not, you get what's handed to you in the podcast version.
Yeah, or you can listen live, and maybe Greg's microphone will explode, and you might get some of that.
Nope. Those days are done, Joe.
They're done.
We've done grown up into the beautiful butterfly we are today.
That's right.
We were a caterpillar that had microphones that would blow up on us, and now we're a butterfly. We're flying high like beautiful butterflies do, huh, Joe?
We don't give a fuck.
We are beautiful butterflies that don't give a fuck. Thanks, Heidi.
Yeah, how about Corey Wootton, though, tonight? Before we get off, you know, I think that's our first former or current Chicago Bear to join the show. So,
yeah, that's true. I'm, like, going back on our guests in my head.
You never know. We forget. That's the thing. We forget. You never know. Did Adam Johns play for the Bears? I forget.
Yeah, I'm like, no. Yeah, no, I'm certain that is our first former Chicago Bear on the show.
That was a good idea with the station ID, you know? That was a trick from the old Phil Atoshin, you know, tricks of the trade to pop that in at the end, you know?
Oh, for sure, man. Like, you had him on a roll going, so I just quickly shot you a message. I'm like, station ID, bro.
I said, thanks again, man. He said, no problem. Glad I could jump on. And that's what I love about Corey. He's so down to earth. I saw him at the fourth preseason game. He was hanging out at the bottom of the field. And he's actually trying to meet one of his friends, and they wouldn't let him down. And I went to the usher. I was like, dude, this guy used to play for the Bears. Let his friend through. He's like, oh, okay. So it was, like, kind of nice to see him and kind of just hot shot it out there. Like, hey, would you mind hopping on? And you know, he couldn't have been nicer and more gracious with his time. So it's cool to be able to talk to guys that actually put on the pads and know what it's like to be a Chicago Bear and have to face these expectations. And, you know, sometimes you fail and you gotta respond to adversity. So it's cool to hear a player that truly understands that from that perspective. You know, we love the writers and the fans' perspective, but there is nothing better than a player's perspective.
Oh, hell yeah, man. I tell you what, he got me real excited about Leonard Floyd and Roy Robb. I mean, his breakdown of those guys got me really pumped up to see him the rest of the year.
Well, he's the original, you know, Leonard Floyd or Roy Robb, right?
Right,
you know
right.
What I mean? He was the guy that was lengthy. You know, we had Mark Anderson in the Super Bowl days. He flashed that Super Bowl year and got a bunch of sacks. Maybe that's what Leonard Floyd has in store for himself this year. You know, with Khalil Mack on the other side of the line, you should be able to feast with one-on-ones. So, you know, I don't know much about X's and O's with football, but I know that much.
We know that he's a beast, and he's going to get his first full sack of the season. I think I'm calling it Sunday against Joe Flacco. He's going to be a very scared man, so I'm looking forward to watching that happen in slow motion.
For sure. Well, you know, I guess before we wrap it up, last thing I'll say is if you are going to games going forward, and we'll talk about this here in a few weeks because we don't have another home game, but this ticket situation is just, I had more problems getting into the stadium again, and I was going in right when the gates were open so I could get my bobblehead and get to my seat, and it's complete chaos, and I really hope they figure out how to get Wi-Fi hotspots in each entrance because there just is no service. And it's impossible to pull up your ticket, and it was really frustrating, you know, just fan experience-wise to get into the stadium. So I hope they circumvent that, truly, because it was a nightmare, to put it mildly. And, you know, I just want to get in. It really frustrates me. So really, that's what – the only solution is a Wi-Fi hotspot in each gate, because if not, you got so many people that can't pull up their tickets. You got these – supervisors that have to come over and try to help them, and they can't. There's nothing you can do other than to say, this guy was, I couldn't pull mine up. He's like, well, you got to go somewhere to pull up your phone. Well, where is that? You want me to go stand on Lakeshore Drive? Like, come on. You know, the most frustrating part is once you get into the stadium, Wi-Fi is available, but you have to be in the stadium. Now, once you're in, you can pull up Wi-Fi and pull up your ticket all you want, but 10 feet outside the stadium where you need to get in, there is no service. So, really frustrating as far as, you know, just fan experience. That's the only thing I wanted to say because, you know, we are the fans in the stands. We want to give everybody the best advice we can, you know. But just continue. Make sure you're practicing using your mobile ticket.
And Greg, because, I will tell you, I noticed I updated the Chicago Bears app on my phone, and there was a little note in the update that it's improving digital tickets. It didn't say what exactly it's doing, but whatever, they must know it's a problem, so whatever they did is supposed to be helping the system. So I'm not sure. Hopefully it helps.
It better, because it was a nightmare, and I just don't, you know, because then you have to get in. Now they give you these vouchers for these bobbleheads, and like at Wrigley, they'd give you the bobbleheads right when you come through the gate. But I guess they're probably in their heads like, oh, let's put it away from the gates because we already have enough madness at the gates. And maybe that makes sense. But it kind of sucks, too, because once you fought your way through the original gate, now you got to go fight your way into this line for the bobbleheads. And, Joe, you saw how it was in the preseason and how chaotic it was. It was 15 times as bad for the regular season game on Thursday. And it really sucks for the guys coming in from the north gate because it's close. Where they have the bobblehead tent located is closer to the south entrance.
Right.
So all these people that are coming in from the north side, they come over. By the time they get over where the gate or for the tent for where the bobbleheads are, the line is already ridiculously long. I mean, and when I say ridiculously long, I mean ridiculously long. By the time you get in and then get your bobblehead and then get to your seat, it's like, I don't know, for me, I started going into the stadium early a few years ago because I wanted to get right to the field while they're warming up. Now all this stuff takes so long, I can't even do that anymore. And it's just like, ugh, it's really frustrating. I get it. First world problems. People got bigger problems in this world. But just from a fan's perspective, these are the things on the top of my head right now.
Well, Greg, let me ask you, who was the bobblehead this week?
Mike Ditka.
Oh, very nice.
The Dick, yeah.
Is it they just, were going. Is it like the Red Grange one, like same size, kind of small?
Yep. Same size, Dick. Got Red Grange, and then Bill George was the other one for the fourth preseason game. And, they're cool, you know. They're creating quite some havoc, but they're cool. You know, they're going quick. I hear they're selling for big money on eBay waiver wires, but I probably won't give mine up.
Yeah, well, did you see who the bobblehead is on the Saints game, Greg?
Was that Hester?
Oh, it's Sweetness.
Oh, Sweetness, wow. Hey, that's a good one because they won their Super Bowl in New Orleans, so they're playing New Orleans. Sweetness bobblehead, why not?
Hell yeah, man. That's going to be a good one. I'm excited to get that one. So
it'd be cool to get them all, but you got to go to them all to get them all.
Well, did you see that season ticket holders, Greg, got a special package with the Mac and Hallis bobblehead?
Yep. It's pretty cool. My wife's boss is a season ticket holder, and he gave me the box. He didn't give me the bobbleheads within it, but he gave me the box and all the little pamphlets that came with it.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's nice tin, big box, so I can put all my keepsakes in there. And but yeah, they came with bobbleheads too. He didn't give me those because he's selfish. No, I'm kidding. But yeah, it's I want the Hester bobblehead for sure. I got my eyes on that. The sweetness one would be cool, of course. Hopefully, he's got the high leg kick. I'm sure he does. You know, what did you think of the statues? You know, that's the other thing.
Look awesome, man.
Yeah, you know, some people were hard on the sweetness statue. I can see where some people could improve it with their own. But you know what? We're all, you know, if we could do it, we'd be statue builders. So, you know, the guy that did it did a nice job. And the George Hallis one's amazing, too. Yeah. So, really cool. That's the side of the stadium I always come in because I park always in the south side of the stadium in the McCormick garage or, you know, at the corner of Wabash and Cermak, where the Chicago Bears tailgating club guys are, or even in South Lot. And so to walk up through that tunnel of love, as I like to call it, where everybody chants Green Bay sucks, and then you come out of it, and to see now, well, you used to just walk up and it was Soldier Field and the flags sticking high in the air and the emblem of Soldier Field and the stadium. And now there's these two iconic statues on the right and left side as you walk up the stairs as you're right getting ready to go in the stadium. It's really cool. It just adds to the experience for sure.
Yeah, it's I can't wait to see him in person, and I can't wait to see some more Bears games. Just Denver, Chicago coming up on Sunday.
Broncos, Bears, 3:25. Let's get Montgomery his carries. Let's get Money Mitch cooking. We need to get him in play action, get him on the move, play action, roll out. He had that one, like we pointed out on the tape, never lies. He throws a complete rocket dime ball to the corner on a nice rollout. You know, let's get this guy moving again. Let's get David Montgomery going. Hopefully the defense can get some interceptions for touchdowns. And let's just blow this team out of the water so everybody can chill out because, you know, it's a lot more fun when everyone's loving on the Bears. This week has been tough, you know, with everyone with their pitchforks and axes out.
Yeah, man, it's gonna be a fun season. I'm just ready for them to pick it back up and hopefully make us forget all about that terrible week one loss. Greg, awesome show tonight, man. Corey Wootton, absolute class act, amazing guest and friend of the show.
Yeah, we gotta add it to the drop now. We gotta add it to the intro.
Oh yeah, I could add that to the open, no problem.
Let's go. I like it. Yeah, he was great. Corey Wooden. Oh, Bears Unleashed, 9:30 p.m. Central Time on Fox 32 on Fridays. You know, they're just starting their first show last week, so good Bears conversation going on there. Make sure you check that out. You know, and yeah, like we said again, make sure you're watching or listening in for Bears 100 Proof tomorrow night. What time are they getting started, Joe?
I believe it's 8 Central, 9 East, but I'd have to double-check that with the gentleman.
Well, either way, just make sure you're on the lookout for Bears 100 Proof tomorrow night. They're going to be breaking down, you know, what they saw, Bears-Packers, the talking about tape never lies, you know, what Phil saw, and then obviously what to look forward to here with Bears-Broncos, and we'll see what if they have any surprise guests or anything like that. But, yeah, and then we get into the weekend and Barfly Tailgate Show and everything else, you know, Draft on Tap and, you know, everything else that's cooking.
Yep. I just confirmed, Greg, it's going to be 8:00, 8 Central tomorrow, live on Mixlr.
There you go. And one quick shout out to Bobby Bombs, our man of the service, the man of Bears Barroom. He's flown out to Japan, serving our country. Shout out to you, Bobby. I know he had a safe flight. He's out there safely. Wanted to make sure we give him a shout out. You know, he protecting the freedoms that we have, and
amen.
We're able to talk sports and have fun, and he's over there in Japan, you know, working for this country, working for you and me. So shout out to you, Bobby. Thank you for all you do.
Appreciate you, Bobby.
Yeah, proud to call you a friend, my man.
Amen to that, brother.
So Joey, this has been a great show. You know, we had a former Bear on, and hopefully next week we get to talk about our first Bears win of Shy Fans in the Stands.
Let's book it, baby. Let's book it. And what better way to book it, Greg, than ending the show with a Chicago icon?
Yeah, we always end it with our man Kanye. What you say, Shy City?
And you say, Shy City. Shy City. Shy City.
I'm coming home again. Do you think about me now and then?
Yeah.
Do you think about me now and then? Cause I'm coming home again.
This girl when I was 3 years old, and what I love most, she had so much soul. She said, excuse me, little homie, I know you don't know me, but my name is Wendy, and I like to from